HarperCollins presents Vita Nostra by Marina and Sergey Dyachenko, read by Jessica Ball. Part 1. The prices. Oh, the prices were simply ludicrous. In the end, Mum rented a tiny room in a 5-story building, 20 minutes from the shore, with windows facing west. The other room in the 1-bedroom apartment was occupied by a young couple, with whom they would have to share the kitchen, bathroom, and toilet.
"Those two are on the beach the whole day," reasoned the landlady. "They are young. They don't need much. The sea is right there. You can almost see it out of your window. Pure paradise."
The landlady departed, leaving behind 2 keys, one for the main entrance and one for the door to their room. Sasha dug her faded, last year's swimsuit from the bottom of the suitcase and changed quickly in the bathroom, where someone else's underwear was drying on the space heater. She felt joyful and giddy. Just a few more minutes, and hello, sea, here we come. Waves, salt on her lips, deep, khaki-coloured water. All that was forgotten during the long winter. Transparent water changing the colour of her skin to yellow-white. Swimming toward the horizon, feeling the sea glide over her stomach and back, then diving deep down, staring at the rocks on the bottom, seaweed and tiny speckled fish.
"Should we eat first?" Mum asked.
She was exhausted by the long trip in the stuffy economy class seats, the apartment search, negotiations with potential landlords. None of it was easy.
"But, Mum, we came to spend time at the beach."
Mum lay down on a couch, a pack of fresh linen under her head, substituting for a pillow. "Want me to run down and get some donuts?" Sasha aimed to be a dutiful daughter.
"We're not going to live on donuts here. We have a decent kitchen."
"Can't I at least take one little dip?"
"Fine." Mum closed her eyes. "Get some eggs and yogurt on the way back. Oh, and bread and some butter."
Not hesitating, lest her mother change her mind, Sasha threw a sundress over the swimsuit, slid her feet into a pair of sandals, grabbed a beach bag and one of the towels provided by the landlady, and ran outside into the sunshine. She had no proper names for the blossoming trees that grew in the yard, but decided to call them peacock trees. Behind the unevenly trimmed bushes began the street that led to the shore. Sasha decided it was going to be called just that, the street that leads to the sea. The street sign bore the real name, but it was plain and insignificant. It happened so often, beautiful things had stupid names, and the other way around. Swinging her bag, she walked, no, ran down the street. People moved in a thick throng, some carrying inflatable mattresses and large sun umbrellas, others burdened only with a beach bag. Children, as expected, were covered by melting ice cream, and their mothers scolded them, wiping faces and shirts with their crumpled handkerchiefs. The sun had toppled over the zenith and now hung above the distant mountains, choosing a place to land. A languid smile on her lips, Sasha walked towards the sea, hot asphalt burning through the soles of her sandals. They'd made it. They'd made it despite the lack of money, despite Mum's problems at work. They'd made it to the seaside. And in only 10 minutes, Sasha would dive into the water. The street twisted. The sidewalk was almost entirely blocked by advertisements for tourist attractions. The Swallow's Nest, Massandra, Nikitsky Botanical Garden, Alupka Palace. The din of video games filled the air. A mechanical voice, coming from a metal contraption in front of the arcade, offered palm reading. Sasha ignored it all and instead stood on tiptoes. And finally saw the sea. Restraining herself from breaking into a gallop, she ran down a steep hill toward the high tide, toward the happy squeals of children and the music of beachside cafes. So close. Of course, the closest beach had an entrance fee. Not letting herself be annoyed by a simple fee, Sasha ran around the fence, jumped off a low concrete railing, and felt the pebbles crunch under her feet. She found a spot on the rocks, threw her towel and sundress down on her beach bag, took off her sandals, and made her way down, wincing from the gravel biting into her feet. As soon as she got to the water, she dove in and swam. This was happiness. In the first second, the water seemed cold. In the second, warm, like freshly drawn milk. Right near the beach, seaweed and fragments of plastic bags swayed gently in the waves. But Sasha swam farther and farther away, and the water became clear, leaving behind inflatable mattresses and children with bright-coloured floaties. The sea opened all around her, and a scarlet buoy flashed like a sign of perfection between two stretches of turquoise cloth. Sasha dove, opened her eyes, and saw a school of grey, elongated fish. On the way back, she ran. Mum was probably worried. The uphill road seemed unexpectedly long and steep. She stopped at a store where a harried saleswoman sold bread, eggs, and potatoes, and the queue was long and solemn. After enduring the line for nearly half an hour, Sasha filled up her bag with groceries and ran down the street that leads to the sea into the garden with the peacock trees. A man stood near a rental agency, a green booth with permanently closed shutters. Despite the heat, he wore a dark denim suit. Under the peak of his dark blue cap, his face had a jaundiced, waxy tint. Dark glasses reflected the sun's rays, but Sasha managed to catch his glance. She cringed. She looked away from the strange man, entered the hallway that smelled of many generations of cats, and walked up to the second floor, to the door upholstered in black faux leather with a tin number 25 on it. Every morning, Sasha and her mother woke up at 4, when their neighbours, the young couple, returned from a nightclub. The neighbours stumbled up and down the corridor, made tea, made the bedsprings creak, and eventually fell quiet. Sasha and her mother dozed off again and woke up next around 7:30. Sasha made instant coffee for both of them. The kitchen sink brimmed with dirty plates. The neighbours apologised profusely for the mess, but never did the dishes. And they headed for the beach. On the way to the shore, they bought little cups of yogurt or freshly steamed corn, sparkling with salt crystals or jam donuts. They rented one plastic lounge chair to share, spread their towels over it, and ran toward the water, stumbling on the sharp gravel and hissing from pain. They plopped into the water, dove in, and lingered in the waves. On the second day, Sasha got a sunburn, and Mum smeared yogurt on her shoulders to calm the sting. On the fourth day, they went on a harbour cruise, but the waves were choppy, and both of them felt a touch of motion sickness. On the fifth day, there was a real storm, and half-naked lifeguards strolled around the beach, announcing, "Can't swim, alligators abound," as Sasha's mother quoted from an old children's rhyme. Sasha played with the waves and managed to get slammed by an errant rock. The painful bruise took a long time to heal. In the evenings, the whole town was drowned in music, streaming from nightclubs. Clusters of guys and girls armed with cigarettes stood near the kiosks or box office windows, or sat around old iron benches and participated in social engagements, expected of adolescent mammals. Occasionally, Sasha caught their appraising looks. She did not like those guys with their obnoxious, overly made-up girlfriends, yet she felt uneasy. It was embarrassing for a normal 16-year-old to be vacationing with her mother like a little girl. Sasha would have liked to stand just like this, in the centre of a noisy group, leaning on a bench and laughing with everybody else. Or to linger in a cafe, sipping gin and coke from a tin can. Or to play volleyball on a square patch of asphalt, split by long cracks like an elephant hide. Instead, she would just walk by, pretending she had some urgent, much more fascinating business to attend to, and spend her evenings strolling around with her mother in the park or along the boardwalk, gazing at the creations of the never-ending street artists, haggling over lacquered shells and clay candle holders, doing all these rather nice and not at all boring things. But the peals of laughter coming from the teenage clusters sometimes made her sigh heavily. The storm subsided. The water had been freed of the mud that clung to it. The sea regained its transparency, and Sasha caught a crab, as tiny as a spider. She let it go right away. Half of their vacation had already dissolved into nothingness. It seemed as if they'd just arrived, and now only 8 days remained. She met the man in the blue cap at a street market. Moving along the rows, Sasha was pricing black cherries when, rounding the corner, she saw him in the midst of the shoppers. The man stood nearby, his dark glasses turned toward Sasha. She was sure he was watching her, and her alone. Sasha turned and pushed towards the market exit. After all, she could buy the cherries at her street corner. It was more expensive, but not so much that it was worth sticking around. Swinging her plastic bag, she entered the street that leads to the sea and strode up to her apartment building, trying to stay in the shade thrown by the acacia and linden trees. She looked back after half a block. The man in the dark denim suit was following her. For some reason, she'd believed he had stayed at the market. Of course, there was the possibility that he needed to go in the same direction, but she was not that naive. Staring into the impenetrable lenses, she felt unutterable terror. The street was packed with beachgoers and vacationers. Ice cream was melting down children's fronts in the same way as before. Open-air kiosks were just as busy, selling bubblegum, beer and vegetables. The afternoon sun was just as scorching. But Sasha's instant chill felt like a lining of frost in her stomach. Not really aware of why she was so afraid of the dark man, Sasha shot up the street, her sandals drumming a feverish rhythm and passerbys hastily moving out of her way. Gulping air, not daring to look back, she burst into the yard with the peacock trees. She leapt into the hallway and rang the doorbell. Mum took a long time to open the door. Downstairs, in the entrance hall, a door opened and Sasha heard footsteps. Mum finally made it to the door. Sasha dove into the apartment, nearly toppling her mother. She slammed the door closed and turned the key. "Are you crazy?" Sasha clung to the peephole. Looking distorted as if through a funny mirror, their next-door neighbour walked up the stairs, carrying a bag of cherry plums, and went farther up to the third floor. Sasha started breathing again. "What happened?" Mum's voice was tense. "Nothing, really." Embarrassment moved in. "Somebody was following me."
"Who was?"
Sasha began to explain. The story of the dark man, when narrated logically, did not seem frightening, only ridiculous. Nothing she said made any sense, and Mum clearly wasn't alarmed. "I assume you did not buy any cherries?" Mum concluded. Sasha shrugged guiltily. The right thing to do was to pick up her bag and return to the market, but the very idea of opening the door and walking out into the yard made her knees shake. "I suppose I might as well do it myself," Mum sighed. She picked up the bag and money and left for the market. Next morning, on the way to the beach, Sasha saw the dark man again. He stood by the tourist centre, pretending to examine the offered tools and prices, but in reality he was watching Sasha from behind his dark mirrored lenses.
Mum, look!
Mum followed Sasha's gaze, her eyebrow lifted. I don't understand. Some guy standing there. And?
You don't see anything weird?
Mum continued walking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.